Hi guys, welcome to Electrical Project channel. Today I'm going to build version 2.0 of my magnetic levitation device. Previous version was unstable and required a power supply with adjustable voltage, which is not good. So I did some experimenting and came up with this circuit. Testing showed good results, so I decided to make a complete device. By complete I mean to implement it on a PCB and make a frame for the device. Well, here is the PCB that I created in KiCad. It is my first KiCad project, but I hope it will work fine. This is how completed PCB should look like. I'm going to make PCB at home, which is a little bit challenging but doable. I did it before, but it was a long time ago. Well, let's do it. The first step is to print the PCB layout. Now we need to transfer it to a copper clad board. I need to align it properly. Now we need to apply some heat. The next step is to remove the paper. I need to remove the paper without removing the toner. This is not the only way to make PCBs at home. I remember using photoresist to make pretty complicated PCBs with good quality. But it was a long time ago and I don't have photoresist now, so I'll use this simpler method. There are still present microfibers from the paper. I need to remove them. Now it is time for etching process using iron chloride. And after some time, copper that is not covered with toner disappears. Now after etching finished, I've got this. Let's clean it. And here is the result. Well, it's not perfect, seems like iron chloride got through the toner. Well, it's not perfect, but still usable. Okay, here goes the next step. The next step is simple, I need to drill holes. So let's do it. And here goes the fun part of the project. It is the assembly of electronic components to the PCB. I'm going to start with the heatsink. Heatsink dissipates a lot of heat, so I use 60 watt soldering iron to solder it properly. For other components, I'm going to use my regular soldering iron. Next, I decided to solder MOSFET, but it's pretty arbitrary. Now let's solder trimmer potentiometer. And now let's solder electrolytic capacitor. Polarity is important here, so pay attention to polarity markings. When it's done, let's solder the diode. Polarity is important here as well. Cathode needs to be soldered to the positive trace on the PCB. Now let's solder the LED. Longer lead is anode lead. Anode later will be connected via SMD resistor to the positive trace on the PCB. Now let's solder TL431. Looking at TL431 electronic symbol, some may think that it's some kind of weird Zener diode, but it's actually just an integrated circuit. TL431 is commonly used in power supplies. Now let's solder 78L05, which is 5V voltage regulator. And when it's done, let's solder jumper wire. And now it is time to solder SMD components. Let's connect 1K resistor that connects LED to the positive PCB trays. Now one more 1K resistor. And here goes 100 nanofarad capacitor. One K resistor again. And now one microfarad capacitor. Okay, now I'm going to solder two of the 330K resistors. They are connected sequentially, so together they make 660K resistance. You can of course try to use a little bit different values, but I experimentally found out that values about 600K work well. Okay, now it is time to solder wires. There is not much to explain here. Two wires needed for power. And two wires will be connected to the electromagnet. Also, we need three thinner wires that will be connected to the Hall effect sensor. And that is it. Also, I use hot glue, so bending doesn't damage wires. Now let's clean the PCB. And now I realize that I forgot to solder one microfarad capacitor. Well, this capacitor is not that important, but let's solder it. Now let's clean it. Now I covered the PCB with old expired photoresist spray. It will work as a protection layer. You can use nail polish instead. Transparent nail polish should look even cooler, but I use what I have. Also, I decided to apply the thermal paste between MOSFET and heat sink. It is not necessary, but it potentially should make things better. Perfection is not attainable, but we can try. Now let's make a small PCB for a Hall effect sensor. I need to cut copper layer into three different pieces. Now I'm going to salvage Hall effect sensor from old floppy disk readers PCB. But you can also find them in motors of CD-DVD drives. Now let's solder Hall effect sensor to the PCB. And now let's solder wires. The black wire we need to connect to the bottom of the PCB. On the main PCB, black wire is connected to the ground plane. Now let's connect the red wire to the top right square. On the main PCB, red wire is connected to a 1K SMD resistor. And let's connect the blue wire to the top left square. On the main PCB, blue wire is connected to 10K trimmer potentiometer. Now let's clean the PCB. And that is it. You can even do some tests now. By adjusting potentiometer, you can change the sensitivity. Now let me show you specs of the electromagnet I'm going to use. I did not make this coil, I've got it from some device. It is 31 ohms, 58 millihenry. Now you need to tune the device. You need to adjust potentiometer in a way so LED turns off when you bring the magnet close to the sensor. Now when LED is on, bring the magnet to the electromagnet. You should feel attraction, not repulsion. If you feel any repulsion, it means you connected electromagnet with the wrong polarity, so you need to reverse the polarity. Now let's test it. Well, it kinda works. Also, I recommend covering the whole sensor's PCB with hot glue, because sometimes the magnet heats the sensor and can damage it. Now I need to mount PCB to the frame. So I need to drill holes in the PCB. I should have thought about it before, but let's do it now. Also, I drilled holes in the frame, so let's mount the PCB. These screws are overkill here, but again, I use what I have. Okay, the PCB is mounted now. So let's continue building the frame. You can come up with a completely different frame idea. This is just an idea that I came up with. You can of course use this device without any frame at all. You'll just need to hang electromagnet somewhere. It's all up to you. Well, there is not much to comment here, so enjoy me not talking. Also, there should be some space between the electromagnet and the Hall effect sensor. Otherwise it will not work. You can use some plastic or something similar. the device can work in a wide range of voltages, from 8 volts up to 16 volts. Volts is the limit just because I've used 16 volts electrolytic capacitor. I think 12 volts should be perfect choice for this device. I'll use a 12 volt DC power supply for powering. Such power supplies usually used with routers, so it is easy to find one. It can even levitate my wire cutters, so it probably could work as some fancy advertising setup. And that is all. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and see you in another one.